you. Let me simply give thanks for your courage and your persistence and your ability to get over the fight and remember what it is to be church.
Amen.
Your witness to the rest of the church about being church, even if you don't have a building, has changed lives and congregations all across this church. You may not realize that, but it's been really powerful. When you discovered that you didn't have to be angry with somebody sitting next to you in the pew, or fighting about this point or that point, and remembered that our job is really to serve our neighbors, look at what's happened here. Give yourselves a round of applause. You've really done remarkable things and become a remarkable group of human beings called church. I think I'm supposed to talk about spirituality out in public, but I think you're already doing it. I sat and thought about things that I might talk about and realized that you're already doing many of them, if not all of them. I'm going to say a few things, and then I hope we can get a conversation started. How many of you are from St. Christopher? How many of you are from another congregation? Good, good, good. We get some cross-fertilization going. Have you heard of the five marks of mission? Many of you. The Anglican Communion adopted five marks of what God's mission looks like in the mid-80s, so more than 30 years ago. They're a helpful framework for thinking about how we love our neighbors as ourselves. Proclaim the good news of the kingdom of God. You know, that's in the baptismal covenant. Do it by word and example. How many of you know or have been working with the way of love? Presiding Bishop Michael has started that. It's a wonderful way to begin to think more concretely about being on the journey all the time. I commend that to you. And there are more and more resources all the time. There's a Lenten program. You can get on the Episcopal Church website /way of love and find it. There are also resources at Forward Movement. Perhaps the most important thing we can do in terms of proclaiming good news is ask somebody else to tell his or her story. We don't do that very often. We want to tell our story. But giving somebody else the opportunity to tell their life story is a way of witnessing. Where has God been active in your life? Where have you been found when you were lost? Where have you been helped or rescued by the people around you? Nell Morton was had a wonderful phrase called hearing people into speech. Making enough space for somebody to feel safe to tell her story or his story. It's an incredible gift we can give to other people. It's part of proclaiming good news, that there is somebody there to receive and hear and bless that story. Ashes to Go, I heard about Ashes to Go today. I've been stunned at how many people come to get their ashes who may not go to church at all the rest of the year. But it's their moment in the year of connecting with their mortality and the fact that somebody loves them even in the midst of their mortality. It's really important. I remember I was in Costa Rica more than 10 years ago, and the diocese took me to visit a school on Ash Wednesday, a preschool, and the teachers were bringing these toddlers up to get ashes on their heads. If that isn't powerful, I don't know what is. And in that culture, it's taught. It's taught. What about pub theology? Anybody heard of pub theology? Conversations about theological issues or whatever anybody wants to ask. I remember hearing a church planter once talk about going to Starbucks and putting a little table tent on the table that says, tell me your stories about God. It's both of those. It's an offer to hear somebody's story, and it's a way of being present that says, I'm safe. You can ask me anything you want. We can talk about whatever you want. That is deeply good news for many, many, many people in this world. Second mark of mission is to teach, baptize, and nurture new believers. If we're telling our stories or asking other people theirs, there's an opportunity for that. It's connected. In the Diocese of Albany, a number of years ago, I made a visit, and they took me to see what a congregation was doing, and this was in the middle of winter. There was a little snow on the ground. They put a little card table out on the street, on the sidewalk outside the church, with a little sign that said, we'll pray for you. And people walking down the street toward the coffee shop or the shops in the middle of town would stop and tell people what they wanted prayer for and keep going on their way. It was a remarkable idea, I thought. And they do it regularly. They're not out there 24/7, but they're out there a couple times a week for an hour or two. Anybody heard of Messy Church? Messy Church started in London, in England, and it's an opportunity for often parents of small children to bring their kids for a little gospel teaching, sing a song, do a Sunday school kind of craft, probably on Thursday afternoon at 4 o'clock. And it's an invitation into church culture for parents who probably don't have any experience of it. But it's available. It suits the context. You know, most 3 or 4 year olds don't understand what's going on in our services. It's meant to be messy and noisy, because that's what small children do so well. Common Cathedral, Ecclesia Ministries, sometimes it's called. A number of dioceses around the church have regular worship services in a city park, which often feels safer to people who don't live in regular housing. There's one in Atlanta, there's one in Boston. It's an opportunity to meet people where they are, to build relationships, to sit and eat together after worship, to get to know people, to widen our understanding of community. Another option I am aware of is sometimes called wild church, literally going into the wilderness. Church of the Woods in New Hampshire. There is a shelter at Church of the Woods. There's a barn where they go when it's really, really bad weather. But even then, they'll go out and spend some time giving thanks for creation, for the wonder of God's creation. And they have a prayer service, a Eucharist, out in the woods. Some of you know about Dinner Church. St. Lydia's Dinner Church is one of the better known ones, started by a Lutheran pastor in Manhattan, gathering young adults to cook a meal together. And eventually it morphed into a worship service. You remember the Last Supper? You know, that was the first dinner church. The first dinner church. And it's started in a number of places across the church. Again, it's a way to meet people where they are. What about, how do you share your faith in the workplace in ways that are appropriate? Often it's about building relationships that are safe enough to talk about what's most important to you. or to hear somebody else begin to explore that possibility. We can do it wherever we are if we're conscious about it. Third mark of mission is about responding to human need through loving service. And I know you do this. Laundry Love, Thistle Farms, you know about Becca Stevens' movement to provide shelter and community and employment and dignity and healing to women who've been in abused situations. It's remarkable. San Diego's got something I hadn't seen before called Showers of Blessing. They have a trailer with a bunch of showers in it that they tow to a place where they provide showers for people who are homeless or underhoused once a week, once a month. It's a remarkable ministry of dignity. A number of congregations with excess land have begun to think about building housing. St. Mary's in Anchorage had, I don't know, a 7 or 10 acre parcel and has some woods on it. But they had enough room, and there's very little senior housing in Alaska. They built a community housing that had, I don't know, a half a dozen, 10 apartments, and a community room where people could gather and for meals, for fellowship, in ways that were a little homier than the institution. And it's on the grounds of the congregation, where the church is, so there's some built-in community and support for people as they age. In Savannah, Georgia, a rector looked at the old row houses, basically, in the middle of town, and said, we could do something about rehabbing those for affordable housing, and they have. God has given most of our congregations interesting assets. Sometimes it's land, sometimes it's expertise, sometimes it's paying attention to the needs in the neighborhood. That's an asset. We don't always see it that way. But when we know that housing is an issue or hunger is an issue, it draws the love of God out of us. Have you ever walked the neighborhood where your church is? Good for you. Good for you. What have you learned? What have you discovered by walking the neighborhood?
It's empty.
People think we're Jehovah's Witnesses.
Wow. Well, there's an opportunity for conversation. That's pretty amazing.
In the neighborhood right around us, when we built this building, we walked the neighborhood, I think, 3 full times to more than 150 homes. Just tell them that this would be the biggest house in the neighborhood, and they would be welcome here. Because there's no place for kids around here. But we found out that more than a third of them were Hispanic families with most of the children, and another third were elders living alone. And it's beginning to turn now. It's turning younger again. But we gave a picnic, a hamburger cookout, and had game days up here.
Fantastic.
Fantastic. Yeah, we still reach out. You can talk.
Well, you've become a resource for the community once you are known. Fourth mark of mission is a long one. It's to transform the unjust structures of society, challenge violence of every kind, and pursue peace and reconciliation. Your history as a diocese is wrapped up in that kind of work. I mean it. It's in your DNA at this point. I've heard people talk about what happens when all the lawsuits are over, when all the legal stuff is done. There's going to be more work to do. Repairing some of those breaches. Because they're all God's people. And it may not be all sweetness and light, but it can be better than it is now. There are ways that I think that the church and the society around us need to deepen our skills for challenging conversations. There's a program called Living Room Conversations. Good. All right. Okay, you know about that.
Actually, call me if you want to know how.
I got to participate in one several weeks ago. And the circle that I was sitting in, each person tells his or her answer to a question, a provocative question. And the rest, just listen. And the person who started, said something pretty rabid about social justice. And the next person said, well, I can tell I'm at the opposite end of the political spectrum from you. But then she went on to tell her story, and as we went around the circle, it was amazing to recognize that everyone had heard what each person had said. And you could detect the common ground, even if people are at opposite ends of the political spectrum. It's a gift we need in the wider culture, and we can practice it here. Other ways of pursuing justice, advocacy work, Episcopal Public Policy Network, people know about that. It's a way to pester your legislators when there's an issue that the church has made policy about, and we do that at General Convention by passing resolutions. We think it's important that poor people have enough to eat. I'm serious. It's stuff like that. We think that refugees should be treated with dignity. Things like that. We're against the death penalty. We have been since the 1950s as a church. We think abortion is a moral tragedy, but it ought to be available. It shouldn't be legislated. We've had that policy for a long time. So we have some things that we've agreed on that are kind of hot button issues. We don't all agree about those positions, but as a church we've said that together this is what stand we're going to make. A lot of it is really about poverty and justice for the least of us. And that's where much of our advocacy work goes. Do you know your local legislators? Have you ever met with your local legislators? I see nodding heads. Great. They will come and talk to you if you want to discuss an issue with them that you're concerned about. Well, they should. Not always.
We can write to them.
But keep asking. Particularly in election season. Then they'll come. I mean it. It's important. And if you build a relationship, they're much more likely to come when something is hot in the news around you. I encourage that. We talked about living room conversations. And the last one is about safeguarding the integrity of creation and sustaining and renewing the life of the earth. It's about caring for this planet on which God has planted us. I've seen congregations do some amazing things. There's one outside of Washington, D.C. that's adopted its part of the watershed. The creeks and streams that flow eventually into the Chesapeake Bay. And they've become stewards of that watershed. I've seen congregations plant gardens where there was lawn to feed people in the neighborhood and help people feed themselves. In Maryland, they talked about turning food deserts into food forests by planting vegetables and fruit trees that can be available to the neighborhood. It can be beautiful landscaping and food people. There's a great story about a congregation that was in a food desert, and the people in the congregation got together and built a co-op, basically. They bought food together and shared the cost, and everybody got a better deal. And after they'd been doing that for a while, they invited Whole Foods in. And I think lots of people think about Whole Foods as a high-end grocery store, and I think many of them are. But in this neighborhood, they negotiated with Whole Foods to bring the healthy food resource into the neighborhood and to provide jobs for people in that neighborhood who weren't employed, to provide food that was available to everybody and prices that were affordable. It's a win-win for everybody. Churches can do things like that. Sometimes it's a community-sourced agriculture, CSAs. You buy a share in the farmer's produce for the year, and you get a box of vegetables once a week, typically. There's a big congregation in Atlanta that hosts a farmer's market on Saturdays in its parking lot all through the season. You can do things like that. It makes food available to people who don't have adequate access to it. Solar panels. The Diocese of California has challenged every congregation in the diocese to put solar on its roof, to invest in only in renewable energy. You guys have wind. You've got lots of land. Issues around reducing usage, recycling, reusing, and some people say refraining from buying the stuff we don't need. I ran across a remarkable calendar for Lent this year that was about fasting from plastic. I haven't figured out yet how to go to the grocery store and buy food without getting plastic. It's really hard. It's really hard. But there are ways to wrap your food in beeswax cloth instead of saran wrap. We're beginning to figure out how to do things in the ways that our grandparents did, that don't use the degree of waste that gets produced. That's a holy vocation. All of the things I've talked about can be ways of expressing our faith. By valuing the creation that God has given us, by being good stewards of it, by being good stewards of the lives of our neighbors, the human ones and the ones that aren't human. Now, I want to hear some of your stories. I would hope that you might be willing to share what you have tried that's new in terms of sharing your faith with the wider world.
I want to say something. Mm-hmm. I work for Fort Worth ISD, and I don't need a microphone, I don't think. I work for Fort Worth ISD, and I read in the paper somewhere about St. Luke's doing their thing in front of their church. Is it every week? And I was just blown away because I serve over in that community. It's on the east side of Fort Worth. It's I don't know if it's in poverty, but it's lower income kids. And I want you to talk about that because I just love the whole concept.
Thank you, Helen. Yes, and our Coffee on the Corner, as we call it, is hosted every Friday morning. And it actually was born out of a living room conversation. We had the conversation in July. We do the third Tuesday of every month. We host living room conversations. This one was on refugee families and zero tolerance. And there were 8 brave women who came to engage this topic, and we all had very different perspectives, but the heart of it was, we want to do something to be a welcoming presence. And East Fort Worth, we weren't sure how many refugees we had, but we know we have a lot of immigrants on that side of town. So rather than creating some program that we didn't know if was needed or wanted, we got together and decided, let's just be a friendly, welcoming presence in the neighborhood and let folks know we're here and see if we can discover what the needs are. So we did it for a 4 to 6 week pilot program. Every Friday morning, starting the first Friday of the school year, and we have not missed a Friday yet. We continue to do it. It's been a wonderful opportunity to meet the parents, interact with the kids. We have water, coffee, hot chocolate has been a big hit on these freezing cold mornings, and we have a cup with little notes that say, how can we pray for you? We don't push it on anyone. We let them take a card and write a prayer request if they would like to. And there have been lots of God sightings along the way. I won't take up too much time, but if you want to know more of the stories, I'd be happy to share with you. We are positioned across the street from an elementary and catty corner across the street from a middle school. And the relationships continue to develop. And we've looked for ways for a long time to connect with the junior high. And on the first Friday we were there, the middle school counselor was one of our coffee customers, and so we've developed an inroad with the middle school. Very easy. The hardest thing is getting up at 6 o'clock on Friday morning. The rest is showing up. Thank you.
I've seen a congregation in San Diego when finals come to the high school nearby and all the kids are walking to school, they're passing out bags of snacks for finals week. And it's just, they stand on the sidewalk and just greet the kids as they go by. It might be a little more challenging to do with little ones, but who else has got something you want to share?
Oh, my name is Kevin. I'm from St. Albans in Arlington. And I guess there's a couple things, but really the one that I was really excited about. We developed a relationship with an elementary school probably 7 or 8, 9, 10 years ago when we first moved into the theater. And the relationship started out just by writing a check so they could buy uniforms. But a few years ago, that really began to deepen. And last Christmas, so this elementary school is mostly first-generation immigrant folks, kids. And what we realize is that these aren't kids that, like most of us, our moms or dads would give us some money to go to the mall at Christmas time and buy a gift for your parents, right? Go shop for mom. And this wouldn't happen with these kids. And so we worked with the school and with the PTA and the teachers. And using the math department, we developed a Crow Elementary School Christmas market. And so our folks made over 800 handcrafted gifts, enough for every student to get 2. And we had a Christmas market, which we manned and staffed and then worked with parents to help wrap gifts. And the school teachers, the math department, had this whole system worked out where they had a Crow credit card that had a certain amount of money on it every kid. So they had to come in and figure out how much money they had, and the different items cost different amounts of money. And then they had to figure out the taxes. And it was this whole very, really great project that in many ways really deepened the relationship. It helped move us over a hump, I guess you will, from just writing a check into actually being in relationship, because we worked shoulder to shoulder with the kids and the moms and dads and the teachers, and it was great. So it was a cool thing.
Not
done, Father Kevin?
Well, this isn't just us. So the East Deanery, which is comprised of St. Albans and St. Luke's and St. Stephen's and St. Martin's in the Fields, 3 years ago?
Two years ago,
kind of under the kind of prodding of Tony Hyatt. He may not be here.
Not here.
I get this phone call from Tony and says, hey, you want to, you in for putting together a food pantry? Okay. Yes, okay, whatever. And so basically the four congregations went together and using St. Luke's as a base, an operational base, because that neighborhood is a food desert, did some research and partnered with the Tarrant Area Food Bank and started up a food pantry that now is serving about 60 folks on Friday, 60 household units on a Friday, which is, you know, having a couple, several hundred people. And that's been really cool, and now we're ready to expand. When we first started, the bishop's office is right next to it, shares a common wall, and I said, now, you know you're only here 1 week out of the month, so the other 3 weeks, we're going to store food in your office. Soon that wall's going to come down, because we're just going to need the space. And so we're expanding, and it's great. And but the side benefit of not just feeding people is that it has brought the neighborhood onto the campus. And much of the pantry operation is now actually staffed by neighbors, not just Episcopalians. And it has really, I think, deepened the relationship between the four parishes. Because we're working together, we meet each other, we all work on the board together, board of directors together. And so that's really been a side benefit about strengthening, I think, the diocese. So these are all kind of tangential, collateral beauty things.
That's it.
And then out of that, this last year, we had not, at St. Albans, been very successful about doing campus ministry. Really struggled, and said, finally said, we've got to figure something out. We'll just be open to a different idea. And someone brought an article in about some research that had shown that there was a high rate of food insecurity amongst college students. And so we met with the college administrators, and they informed us that the highest rate of food insecurity is really amongst international graduate students because of work visas and stuff. And so we developed a menu for Hindu students and Islamic students. I had no idea there were so many different kinds of Hindu diets. And through the Four Saints, partnered with Four Saints and the food bank, just show up on campus and hand out sacks of food. And now we package 60 sacks of food, and in 2 hours, they're gone. If they would take whatever we brought, but that's about all we can package on. So it's been really cool. And it just shows you that you just don't know. I mean, this was not something that we even thought of, but when you open your eyes, it's there. So.
The campus ministry at UC San Diego is in the process of planning to replace their campus ministry building with a housing project that will have 50 small apartments and that kind of a feeding program as well.
My name is Kelly Graham, and we started a little over a year ago a program called Laundry Love. And we go once a month to third Saturday of every month. And we provide quarters and a meal. We have a children's area, dryer sheets, and just fellowship. When we started it, I think we did maybe 30 loads. And I had many sleepless nights on whether or not people were going to come. And so this past month, we did over 400 loaves.
Wow. Wow.
A washing machine, unused, or dryers, unused. And Father Bill and other helpers handled the children's area, and there were kids on the floor. They had Play-Doh, Legos, drawing, and it's an amazing ministry. Third Saturday of every month, Super Coin Laundry on 8th Avenue. Come see us and see what we do.
LA actually ordained somebody in the laundromat after they started the worship service. I'm serious. I'm serious.
Hi, I'm Melissa Farkey. I go to church at St. Elizabeth's in Christ the King. We're the newly melded parish. That's been doing it for 5 years. And just recently, in this last school year, we decided to go outside of ourselves and try and partner with the Title I elementary school in our neighborhood. And we're about 26 strong on a Sunday, and we've had about 10, 12 people at different times participate in programs with the school. We did school supplies with them at the beginning of the year and helped fulfill school supply needs with a grant from the diocese and a grant from a private person to supply supplies for all 700 students in the school. They didn't have to bring any supplies. And some of the people from our church go into the school once a week and actually read with the students. Trying to get them to that magic number of so many words read to them so they can start reading themselves. And the year before we did Parent University, where we went and babysat, played with the kids in the gymnasium so that the parents who are perhaps struggling with their parenting skills were able to go to a class that the school provided. And so these are all just little ways that we're trying to touch them. And what we're getting back from it is appreciation and just the humility of being able to be with them as they, you know, struggle through things that we're not struggling with. You know, enough food, enough money. And so, thank you.
There's no limit to your imagination. There's no limit to what's possible if you listen and look and see what the needs are. And it's a, I think you are aware that it's a much greater gift that you receive than you give. I think it's probably time for people to go home. I Fort Worth has a very tender place in my heart.
Likewise.
You have been through hell, and you've been resurrected, and you know it, and you show it.
Hey.
And you teach others. So keep the faith and bless you all.
Thank you.